chapter 19, verses 1-12.
Nice.
And it said, so Matthew 19:1-12. When Jesus had finished saying these things, he left Galilee and went into the region of Judea, to the other side of the Jordan. Large crowds followed him, and he healed them there. Some Pharisees came to test him. They asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every reason? Haven't you read that at the beginning of the beginning, the Creator made them male and female, and said, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, God has joined together, let no one separate. Why then, they asked, did Moses command that a man give his wife a certificate of divorce and send her away? Jesus replied, Moses permitted you to divorce your wives because your hearts were hard, but it was not this way from the beginning. I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, and marries another woman, commits adultery. The disciples said to him, if this is a situation between a husband and wife, is it better not to marry? Jesus replied, not everyone can accept this word, but only those to whom it has been given. For there are eunuchs who were born that way, and there are eunuchs who have been made eunuchs by others, and there are those who choose to live like eunuchs for the sake of the kingdom of heaven. The one who can accept this should accept it.
Some of you here will no doubt read books by Stephen King. He is one of the most famous and best-selling authors of all time. And he often does go to writers' conferences and present at writers' conferences. And currently, when he asks for questions at the end, inevitably someone will raise their hand and they will ask the pressing question, Mr. King, tell us, what kind of pencil do you use as you write your books? It's a hard question to ask, isn't it? It's as if knowing what kind of pencil King uses is somehow going to help you to be a better author. It's the wrong question to ask. If you don't have time with Stephen King at a writer's conference, ask a better question than that. Now we're going to see something of that here in the passage that we are looking at this morning. The wrong question is being asked. So this morning we're continuing in the Gospel of Matthew. We are in Matthew chapter 19. And we meet here the topic of marriage and divorce. Now you might be aware that rates of marriage here in Australia in recent years have been as low as ever. Marriage is not valued in the same way as it previously was. And certainly our beliefs about marriage have also changed. But what we're going to see here, as we hear from Jesus, is that actually marriage that is according to God's blueprint, marriage is a good thing that we should value. So in terms of Matthew 19, and you see there in verse 3 that here the Pharisees, the religious leaders of the day, come to Jesus with a question. And the question is there to test Jesus. They ask, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife for any and every reason? So back in Jesus' day, there was this long-standing debate. The debate was around the question, now, what are the appropriate reasons for a divorce? Moses, back in Deuteronomy chapter 24, had allowed for divorce on the grounds of what he called uncleanness. But of course, the next question that arose after that was, well, what is uncleanness anyway? And two different schools of thought arose. One school, following the Rabbi Shammai, said that indecencies refer to adultery. They have a much more restricted view of the grounds for divorce. Whereas the other school, following a rabbi named Hillel, said no, indecency can refer to just any and every offence, no matter how trivial. If your wife burns the dinner, this was literally said, if your wife burns the dinner, that is grounds for divorce, if they So there are these two views. And actually the second view was very popular because it set such a low bar for divorce. So the Pharisees here, they're testing Jesus. They want to know where he comes out in this debate. Jesus, talk to us about divorce, they say. Where do we draw the line? What school are you? And Jesus' answer is essentially to say, bad question. Bad question. You want to nut out all the intricacies of divorce, but actually, I reckon you'd do a lot better if you had a better grasp of marriage. Why don't you focus there? And so you'll notice in verses 4 through to 6 that that's where he goes. He doesn't go to divorce at all. He goes to marriage. He says, you've got your Bibles, don't you? Haven't you been reading them? Haven't you read that at the beginning the Creator made the male and female, united them in marriage, and said that the two become one flesh? So what? God's joined together isn't meant to be separated. So Jesus goes to the original pattern and he says, let's talk about marriage. This lady will acknowledge that sadly because of the hardness of our hearts, divorce has been permitted in certain instances, and there are genuine realities there that we are to acknowledge. But still, Jesus doesn't want that to be the primary talking point. See, the main point of the Pharisees and much of the debate was, how can I get out of marriage if I need to? What's the bend? And Jesus is saying, no, that way of thinking is just all wrong. Your focus is all wrong. Divorce wasn't part of God's good design for humanity. The kinds of questions that you ought to be asking would be something like, what can I do to grow my marriage? How might I help it to flourish? How might I love my spouse better? How might I listen to them? If there's problems, what part might I play in seeking to work toward resolution? If there's deep sin, so is there a path that we might pursue toward repentance and toward reconciliation? Are there wise counselors that may be able to help us through this journey? See, all these questions, they're positioned toward helping marriages stay together, and not only to stay together, but to actually flourish. Whereas the Pharisees, well, their question focuses in on the outcomes. And Jesus is saying, no, you have to understand, marriage is actually a good thing. You should be valuing marriage. You know, if you go back to Genesis chapter 1 and you read the account of creation there, you'll notice, as I'm sure many of you have before, that there's this constant refrain in that chapter as God makes the sun, the moon, the stars, the plants, and so on. And that refrain is, and God saw that it was good. And of course, it's in that context that male and female are then created as the climax of creation, and marriage is instituted. And the message is that marriage, one of God's creation ordinances, marriage is good. we've been taught today to be pessimistic about marriage. And so instead of marrying, people opt for cohabitation, for living together, thinking that somehow this will be a better option. Or if people do marry, we are sorely tempted to pull the pin if we're going through a difficult period. But actually, marriage, even lifelong marriage, as Jesus describes it, is a good thing. Timothy Keller, in his very helpful book, The Meaning of Marriage, spends a fair bit of time on this. He makes the point that the belly aching that goes on about people being unhappy in marriage is actually very much overstated. He says, all the surveys tell us that the number of married people who say they are very happy in their marriages is high. About 61 to 62% of there have been a little decrease in this figure during the last decade. Most strikingly of all, he says, longitudinal studies have demonstrated that 2/3 of those unhappy marriages out there will become happy if people stay married and do not become divorced. See, marriage is good. And again, it's not to deny the difficulties that all marriages go through, and it's not to deny the acute sorrow that does come upon men. But it is important that we start here with the goodness of marriage. Marriage is good. And so we move from this question that the Pharisees have asked, and we consider now in more detail the answer that Jesus gives in verses 4 through to 6. Jesus speaks there of God's plan for marriage. We note here four things that Jesus says about God's good plan for marriage. Firstly, marriage, according to God's plan, is between a man and a woman. That's there in verses 4 and 5. Jesus says, haven't you read that at the beginning the Creator made them male and female and said, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife. See, and Jesus actually says that the complementarity of the sexes, our maleness and our femaleness, that's actually part of the reason, the very reason for marriage, he says. For this reason, because of our maleness and femaleness, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife. But marriage is tied to our gender complementarity. And that makes sense, doesn't it? It makes sense because, in fact, one purpose of the one flesh union in marriage is to at least bring about the possibility of children. In Genesis chapter 1, we read that God, having created male and female, blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply or increase in number. So that marriage is the context which God has given to us for children. But lifelong marriage of one man to one woman means that children grow up with their mom and dad. Often today, as we think of marriage, we think about it purely in terms of self-fulfillment, don't we? The good of the individual, what's in it for me. But actually, in the Bible, and even historically, yes, marriage was about the individual, but it was about far more than the individual. It was about more than self-fulfillment. And one piece of the bigger picture of marriage was that it was for the stability, for the welfare of children who are intended to be raised within the context of such a lifelong marriage. So Jesus says marriage is between them. And then secondly, we see here that marriage is exclusive. Okay, notice here in verse 5 that it is only one man and one woman that come together. These two people, there are only two, they come together and they become one flesh. They glued together in what is this exclusive relationship. And what a beautiful thing that is. There was an article a few years back in the UK Daily Mail by the novelist Olivia Fay, and she talked about her journey toward monogamous marriage. Olivia Fay was married at the age of 22, but her marriage was not the usual kind of marriage. Olivia said that she considered marital fidelity to be a, quote, dull task barely worth considering. And her right fiancé, Adam Nicholson, felt the same way. And so they had a marriage contract actually drawn up where her husband was allowed a 2-week affair every year. She was allowed 10 extra marital kisses a year and a 2-week affair every other year. And it was just all just so very open-minded. The problem was it didn't work. The problem was one of his extramarital affairs lasted longer than the 2 weeks, and eventually the marriage fell apart. She was devastated. She writes, "A marriage is like a great fat book, a soap of the highest caliber, an epic on the scale of war and peace, and I have got to know and love all the characters within it. I wanted to know what they do next. My divorce was like losing the only copy in print, when I'd been so gripped, so enthralled by it, knowing it was lost forever." She was devastated. Since then, she's remarried, only her second marriage was different. Her second marriage was very definitely one in which absolute fidelity was promised and expected. She writes, "The removal of the temptation of others is good for a marriage. I have learnt that I am someone who requires absolute closeness. I need to get inside my partner's skin and see the world as he sees it. 20 years on, he is part of me. Infidelity doesn't let that happen." See, God's design for marriage is a good design. Jesus says that marriage is the exclusive. And thirdly, he says that in marriage the two become one flesh. It's there in verse 5. "For the one flesh union there speaks of the unity of marriage," but it does have a particular reference to sex within marriage. And so you notice the order here. Okay, the order here is that a man and a woman have left their father and their mother, and they've been united together as husband and wife, and then they become flesh. The one flesh union is the crowning expression of their marriage relationship. Two have become one. Of course, it serves them to bond them within marriage. But the point that comes last after they've been united as husband and wife. So I don't need to tell you that in our culture today this seems crazy. Today in Australia, it probably won't surprise you to know that 81% of all couples who marry have lived together before marriage. Today, keeping sex before marriage, I mean, it is culture and countercultural, isn't it? But actually, there's great wisdom in it. Because it marks out in a very clear way just the exclusivity of that relationship, and you have a kind of intimacy in that relationship that you just haven't had with anyone else. So don't bring into your marriage the baggage of previous relationships that have that same high level of intimacy. It does protect from a number of problems later on within marriage. Okay, today, as I say, the norm is for people to live together before marriage. The kind of idea, the wisdom is that you try before you buy. But actually, the statistics show that the divorce rates of people who live together prior to marriage are higher than the divorce rates of those who don't live together prior to marriage. Those who cohabit prior to marriage report less commitment to their relationship, less confidence relationship, and more negative communication patterns than those who wait to live together until marriage, in particular for blokes who wait are more committed to their marriage relationship when in marriage. So all of this is just to say that when Jesus that sex comes after marriage, Jesus' pattern here is actually part of his good design for us. Marriage involves one flesh. And also marriage is lifelong. It's there in verse 6. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. But God's intention is for a lifelong union, and that's a good thing. Sadly, there was news just on the weekend that Queensland is now the divorce capital of Australia. We don't value lifelong marriages, but it is good. Okay, what a wonderful thing it is when you see a married couple whose kids have grown up and they've done those difficult years and they grow old together with all of that wealth of shared experience behind them. What a beautiful thing that is. And again, the researchers say that those who've been able to develop that stable relationship over many years, they really do decrease the possibility of loneliness in the older years. But you know, also, of course, even while the kids are around, a continuous marriage has great benefits for the children. It makes for greater levels of stability. And what you find is that there are great cognitive and emotional and social benefits of being brought up within that context. It does make a difference. And of course, it's not that God can't redeem situations outside of that. He certainly can and certainly does. And with Jesus, we can approach our future with hope, whatever our background. Our God is a God of redemption, and so it is important, whatever our background, that through Jesus we know that we can approach our future with hope. But what we're trying to say here is that the pattern for marriage that God's given us, which Jesus recognizes, that pattern is a good pattern. The world wants to say that this is restrictive, but actually, overwhelmingly, Jesus' pattern is beautiful. So we have been dwelling on that this morning for a fair chunk of time intentionally, because we just don't want to jump too quickly into this question that the Pharisees asked here, which is the gospel. But still, at the same time, we do want to recognize that there are valid grounds for divorce. We don't want to give the impression that divorce is always wrong, or again, that God is not able to redeem us in the just the messy situations that we find ourselves in. And so we look at verse 7 as Jesus talks of this topic of divorce. And there the Pharisees push back and they say, okay, Jesus, but did Moses command that a man give his wife a certificate of divorce? And Jesus responds and he says, well, Moses permitted it, he permitted divorce in certain situations, but because of how that had messed things up, again, it's not to be, it's to be the pattern. But Jesus acknowledges the validity of divorce in some situations, but he limits it. In verse 9, he acknowledges sexual immorality as a reason for divorce. Also, Paul, in writing into a different context, which is why I think Jesus doesn't mention it here, but in 1 Corinthians 7:15, Paul mentions abandonment as a valid reason for divorce. So I do think that we would want to be clear that where there is violence in the home, it can amount to a situation where a person is effectively abandoned because they can't exist safely within that relationship. There are valid reasons for divorce. We definitely want to love people well in those situations. We want to care for those who are Okay, it's important to appreciate, for example, that when Moses was actually pleading divorce in Deuteronomy chapter 24, I mean, he was actually seeking to avoid oppression. The common practice in ancient societies was that women were divorced for just any and every reason, just at a whim. You could even do it while you were drunk. And so, of course, I mean, this just left women so vulnerable. But Moses comes in and he says in Deuteronomy 24, no way, there's got to be an actual bill of divorce. This has to be a clear-minded, thought-through thing, and it needs to be over something indecent, which Jesus is clear refers to sexual immorality. And so the laws were there to actually prevent oppression. That's what the point was. And so it's important that in those heartbreaking cases of sexual immorality, of desertion, of abuse, that we're looking out for people, that we're caring for people, that we're loving people, and that we're not stigmatizing those who've gone through that and just actually adding to this sense of being oppressed. That divorces are one of those things that we all wish they were never necessary. Just like we'd all love if we never had to have surgery in our lives, but sometimes people do need to have surgery. Sometimes people, that divorce is the appropriate option. And so, say, Jesus called it cautious when this ought to take place, and I advise anyone in such a difficult situation to be seeking counsel and godly leadership, but still there are times when this is necessary. Do you know, I also want to say here too that where we recognize that we haven't approached things in the right way, where we see our failures along the way, or even where divorces have taken place where it should not have, like, we'll just say that this isn't an unforgivable sin. Remember once a very difficult but also wonderful time with a Christian man. He was just conscience bound by his actions. He was under conviction that he ended his previous marriage and he should not have. He saw the gospel. He saw the gospel which he had known for so many years, and it returned to him again. And he saw once again that the gospel was the right way forward. And he ran his former wife to apologize to her, and they talked, and there was forgiveness offered, and just the freedom that came to him from repentance and knowing the grace of God in this matter. It was one of the most moving things I have ever witnessed. There is grace, there is forgiveness through repentance and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Every failure may be covered by the blood of God. And so we move then in our passage to verses 10 through to 12. And here Jesus addresses the subject of remaining single. In verse 10, you see that the disciples are really quite spooked by everything that Jesus has said. His standard for marriage just seems too high. We surely need an escape hatch that's bigger than that, Jesus. And so they say to Jesus, well, if this is the situation between a husband and a wife, it's got to be better not to marry at all, right? And Jesus responds to them in verse 11 by saying, well, and yet not everyone can accept this. Essentially what he's saying is, if you're not up for it, if you're not up for lifelong marriage, don't get married. It's a high standard. You don't say your vows with your fingers crossed, is essentially what he's saying. But then Jesus goes on, he says, but actually, just to be clear, being single isn't necessarily a bad thing either. And he says there are some people who can't get married. Maybe they had a defect or at birth, or they serve in King's court and they made a unit. So, I mean, so can't, some can't get married fair enough. But also there are some who actually choose it because they know that they will be able to serve the kingdom of God better as a single person. Again, fair enough. So Jesus is saying, you know what, there can be good reasons for people to be single too. And of course, today we have many in our society that are single. But actually, the type of singleness that Jesus is approving of is one that is often looked down on in our world today. And that is because Jesus here is referring to celibate singleness, to chaste that singleness, and that is something which is not quite so popular today. See, in the 21st century West, we are hung up on sexuality. Sex is seen as this really crucial part of our identity. The underlying assumption of so much of what you see in the media is that to be a complete, to be a healthy, to be a whole human being, you need to express yourself sexually. But Christianity says something very different. Because Christianity says, no, there is more to you than your sexuality. And there is more to life than sex. And actually, there can be good reasons for even not expressing your sexuality as you seek to serve God and as you seek to serve others. Okay, Jesus, the most complete, whole human being that has ever been, is one who chose chaste singleness. John the Baptist, called the greatest of all prophets, chose chaste singleness. Paul, arguably the greatest of the apostles, chose chaste singleness, probably after being a widower. Each of these actually saw that there were ways that they could use the freedoms that they had through singleness to serve others and to serve God. Singleness is not to be undervalued. As often the Bible says that singleness is better, there are many good things about marriage too. But what we do want to see here is that Jesus does not hold up your sexual expression as being crucial to your identity or your sense of wholeness as a person. You know, the single Christian, I mean, they actually teach us all a lot about marriage, don't they? The single Christian teaches us a lot because in the end what we learn from their example is that marriage is not what life is all about. Because you can be a faithful servant of Christ whether you are married or whether you are not. You can be someone who is married, and that marriage for you is an opportunity to serve your spouse, to serve your children, to be a place from which you can serve others as you seek to follow the Lord Jesus. Or you can be someone who is single. And that singleness for you is an opportunity to serve your church family, to serve your neighbours, to serve your community, to get involved in a bunch of things that perhaps your married friends can't get involved in as you seek to follow the Lord Jesus. See, whether we're married or whether we're single, it's just not the point. Rather, the point is, am I living for myself and my desires? Or have I been captured by the Lord Jesus? Loved him and gave himself for me. Do I believe that he knows better and that he wants what is my best? And that as I give up my life for him, so in fact I will find life. So whether we're married or single, it really is not the point. The point is, who is the ultimate one that I live for? Do I trust him? So that I will serve, whether in marriage or in sickness. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your good gifts to us. Thank you that you know what is for our good. I thank you for marriage, the good blueprint that you have for us. I thank you for singleness and the great good that a Christian single is to so meaningful. I've got to be conscious that these subjects are never without pain, they're never without difficulty. There are those who go through great hardship in relation to marriage, in relation to singleness. And so do help us to care for one another, whatever the circumstance. And we thank you for the gospel of our Lord Jesus, for the self ourselves.